You are now listening to the House by the Video Store podcast.
Welcome to the House by Video Store podcast. I'm your host, William, and joining me today will be Derek.
Hello.
And Sean.
Hello.
And in this episode, we're discussing the 1986 David Cronenberg remake of The Fly. But before we get to that, we'll go through the things we've been watching recently and a little bit of news and kick things off with some news. It sounds as if to everyone's desires, they're remaking Nightmare on Elm Street again.
Yeah. So the last reboot was, what we said, 2010?
Yeah, it came out in 2010.
Now, was it rebooted before then as well, or was it just like... See, that was the first reboot.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because the... I think it was in the films you had Freddy's dad, and then they didn't see him again. They did New Nightmare, and then after New Nightmare, he was in Freddy vs. Jason. That was the last Robert Englund Freddy appearance. And then the character was done with in films until they did the reboot starring...
Jackie Earle Haley,
who is Rorschach and Watchmen, mm-hmm. and it's been a bunch of stuff. So you had a big long gap in time,
yeah,
between the last two movies in that franchise, and then now you're going to have them, supposedly reboot it again, which I'm not sure that people love the franchise, they want to see more movies, but I think they're in such a damned if you do, damned if you don't place, because even though the last movie technically made money. You know, you can take the worldwide box office and all the merchandising and stuff. It just, a lot of people hated it. So I don't really know what you do with that. Like, you continue to make things that make money that people hate?
I mean...
Suicide Squad, or do you...
Well, it has made a crap load of money.
But the horror franchises, at least, I think you need to go back to basics, make it as, low budget and small as you can, and not get wrapped up in making it a must-succeed proposal.
I agree, not... making the budget balloon too much, but we were talking about what big horror films could you spend a lot of money on, and it's like Friday the 13th, A Nightmare on Elm Street would actually lend itself to but that, just because of the dream sequences. Yeah. Like, that's where you could spend some money on. But
I guess my question is too, I know Ghostbusters is a good example of this, because you look at what the original was made for,
yeah,
and then they made the reboot, and they dropped $180 million or something.
Yeah,
on
the original, if you adjust, I think it was around $30 million. So if you adjust it for inflation to today's dollars, it would be about an $80 million budget.
Yeah.
The new Ghostbusters was double that.
Yeah. But spend money, I mean $50 or $60 million.
So kind of
compared to most,
give it some Deadpool
films.
Money, which is about $60 million.
Like something there.
Well, that's what I was wondering, because to me... with Ghostbusters, it could have been a better movie, in my opinion, if it had only been made on $60 million, which I like the movie. Yeah. But
for horror, though, they kind of gotten themselves in this cycle where horror, a lot of times, like Friday the 13th, Nightmare on Elm Street, they open big, and then they fall off a cliff the next week.
You got
to
know, they don't have legs.
So they don't have any legs, and they don't gross a huge amount internationally. So if you make a $60 million budgeted Friday the 13th or Nightmare on Elm Street, you need it to make at least $300 million worldwide to make your money back. And
another thing,
too,
is what I've learned this summer is a lot of movies bank on a China release. And if you can't get a release in China, Ghostbusters didn't get to go to China. So when we saw how much that hurt that movie, whereas a movie I liked, X-Men Apocalypse, kind of recouped a lot by going to China.
Well, Warcraft was a huge bomb in the U.S., probably won't even make $100 million.
Man.
But in China, it made enough money to possibly get a sequel.
And then another movie to point out, too, that just came out, Suicide Squad, and it's not going to China either. So
and that's a
what's
movie
that
where
going to be?
They said they didn't want it, though.
Yeah.
Well, because it has China, or in China, they don't like the word suicide, so they would have to change the title and stuff like that.
Task Force X or whatever, right?
Yeah. But that's a movie, that's another example of that movie, has a huge production budget and a lot of marketing and advertising, and I think people have given out rough estimates, the studio's a nod, but it needs to make at least $750 million or more to break even,
man,
which is a huge number. Yeah. And so I think a lot of these movies, they're over budgeting, putting way too much CG and stuff in there that doesn't need to be, and setting themselves up to fail if they made a reasonable story and budget.
Yeah.
Well, and back to Nightmare on Elm Street, I don't think Jackie Earle Haley was a bad Freddy.
He just wasn't Robert Englund.
I just think it was all mishandled a little bit, too. I need to watch that again. We need to revisit that for a podcast or something. But
yeah. Yeah,
it did not excite me at all. And I had a lot of potential, and I just don't think it was, like, you know, directed well, really. Well,
and the story itself had problems in mm-hmm. that, you know, you had all this stuff. Like, I've only seen it once, and that's the last time I watched it. But, like, there was, like, the subtext about, like, sexual abuse and was Freddie innocent and, like, all this different stuff. And I think that, you know, kind of just diluted the appeal of the franchise. And
yeah.
So, you know, Freddie went in, you know, at first he started out as being serious and kind of how a lot of horror films are now. They're just straight horror because that's what audiences can handle and want. Should the new one, like the remake, be straight horror, or should they try to go with a lighter tone? Granted, you can't be, you know, they can't, this isn't like a Evil Dead situation where they can bring in a new Bruce Campbell to kind of mimic that humor or recreate it, because that even, like, makes things go flat faster. So, like, I would almost think they need to not take it so seriously.
Yeah, because I think at this point, Freddy Krueger, regardless of who the actor is portraying him, is a character that is bigger than the franchise.
Yeah.
So that alone makes that character hard to be scary, because it's such a known quantity. You can buy a Freddy Krueger doll at Toys R Us, or, you know, kids have T-shirts of it. And, like, so it's this character
that's so baby T-shirts.
It's a character that's so, you know, saturated in culture that it's hard for that character to be scary. So I think it needs to be fun.
He's a lovable character at this point. So it's like, let him have some fun or something. You know what I mean?
I kind of think you're right. I think, like, kind of go with, don't make him such a terrifying figure. Just make gruesome things happen to the people in the movies, and kind of focus on, like, they did later in the movies.
I mean, granted, a lot of people like me don't love those later films.
No,
where it was much more goofy. But that's also But that's also because they didn't have, you know, Wes Craven involved, and the writing of the originals. They had Rennie Harlan directing one of them.
Yeah, but as a kid too, that's the stuff that was the most some of the most memorable stuff was, like, the more outlandish things when Freddy was like I think not necessarily even him being scary and menacing and serious. It was more of him having fun torturing people. You know what I mean? Like, you saw that he had fun and, like, messing with people. Yeah. And that's when it was like the film became, you know, I guess the idea of Freddy was more enjoyable because you saw somebody having fun. Yeah. You know what I mean?
That's like, where, like, a lot of his character came
from too, for sure. You know? So I think they need to maybe, I think it would be worth experimenting, trying to go in that direction.
Yeah. If you're going to reboot it, and the first time you try to reboot it didn't work, maybe go another direction this time. Like you said, maybe go where it's, he's a little more quirky like he was in some of the later ones, and just have a lot of outlandish stuff happen to the
people. I think they need to have, what's Ron Howard's brother's name?
Clint
Howard. Oh, yes.
I think he needs to be the new friend. Just go somewhere. Just go, like, out of left field. Steve Buscemi being Freddy. Like,
Would be awesome.
Just some great character. Well, but, like, a character actor that is, like, so great on his own that.
No, actually, now I want to see Steve Buscemi as.
Yeah.
Yes. But, you know what I mean? Like, give somebody that already kind of has a persona. That way, they're not going to mimic Robert Englund. They're not.
Yeah, they're going to do their own thing.
Let them be, like, a person who's a big personality and, like, infuse that.
Well, wait a minute. I got a better idea. I've always give it to Jared Leto, and that way he can do it, because he will get so, he will become Freddy for, like, a year.
He will murder a group of small children.
Yes. And then talk about how he came from Mississippi 500 times. And that's what we want.
But, So we'll have to wait for more news to come.
Oh, wait a minute. Real quick. They did, the way that Hollywood is right now, they would just give it to The Rock. So,
or no, they give it to Jim Carrey.
Oh, no, nobody cares about Jim Carrey. He'd be The Rock.
They would take
the Rock and everything.
The makeup from the mask. They take the makeup from the mask and all that and just turn it red and orange instead of green. And he's
or, you know, they could go extremely meta and just have Ryan Reynolds do it as Deadpool, because he has the right makeup look. So,
But it's just one of those things where they've, you know, we've been hearing about all these major, you know, Halloween's come back next year. You know, next bit of news.
Possibly.
Well, it's supposed to be, like, I think it's kind of a done deal.
It was the last time, too, and it didn't. So I think
Last time it was, they had, like, a director and a script attached, but then it was kind of in limbo. This time, Blumhouse has set, like, you know, release.
Blumkenhouse?
Yes, they've set a release period and attached producers and stuff, so they'll probably shoot that quickly and get it done. But, So the other bit of news is the Friday the 13th show that was being shopped around at CW is dead. Which isn't all that surprising.
Well, real quick, though, do you think that CW right now, since they have all the DC stuff going on, which is really working well for them, they're just like, you know what, let's just axe this crap over here and double down with.
Well, I think it was awesome.
They're like the DC fans aren't leaving TV to go see the movie.
Yeah,
I think are seeing them, but they're not.
I'm saying like they got, you know, they're kind of doing what Marvel's doing on Netflix. They got something working.
Yeah,
and they got three TV shows. They got the Flash, Arrow, and
there's
Supergirl.
There's other ones. There's like one
and
like
two. I'm saying those are your big three. So I could.
And Friday the 13th, it's you know, we were talking about how you do that as a show with...
Well, I think that's the bigger problem. Yeah, they didn't ever crack a good format.
Like, maybe they didn't figure something out, and then it was better that they abandoned it, because, you know...
Because they have... do they still have the show Supernatural? That's still on, right?
I think they might.
So I don't know.
So they have stuff in the general wheelhouse of horror.
Zombie.
And iZombie. So I think they have the general wheelhouse of things that would work. I just think they didn't get the right approach to it.
All they do in Supernatural is cut people's heads off. Because like, I'm at the gym, it's on the TV, and I swear, like, it's like the goriest TV show. Because like, every time I look up, somebody's getting their face stabbed off or cut in half. I mean, y'all ever watch, like, any of it at all?
No, I've only seen the memes.
It's like, I don't particularly care for it, but it's like the death count in each show is like 20. And somebody always gets decapitated Paris Hilton in the episode the other day. Like, everything she's in, she gets her head cut off or decapitated.
She's in the House of Wax,
which I actually liked House of Wax when I was like 16.
Yeah, it wasn't that terrible. So the Friday 13th show is dead. Another show that we've heard some news about is recently there was a event where they were talking to different TV executives, and the head guy over at Showtime was talking about Twin Peaks, and it's going to possibly break some rules of TV, which is kind of ambiguous as to what that means. Because they've said essentially they shot about two seasons worth of material for the new Twin Peaks that David Lynch, you know, directed and is editing now. And they've said, you know, like the time frame is early-ish, like April to June of 2017 for a possible debut. But they don't know exactly what format that debut will take place in. It could be like Netflix where they drop a bunch of stuff at once, or they could string it out over time or break it into multiple seasons.
Or they could release it all on VHS. Because
yes.
That's never been done in 2016.
Or some people said like maybe they do a super season where if they have two seasons of material, they'll just have it run throughout the course of the year.
What's the main guy's name that's also in Portlandia?
Fred Armisen?
What if they had... No. The mayor from...
Oh, Kyle MacLachlan.
Yeah, had him as his character from Portlandia narrate the beginning of each episode? That has never been done.
No, Dale Cooper became the mayor of Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
Portlandia is the Black Lodge version of the world.
Yeah,
he became the mayor.
So there's really not much details. And you look at the cast list for that, and it's still kind of crazy. It's like, here's Trent Reznor, Eddie Vedder from Pearl Jam. And,
he always loved coming out left field with the casting. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Funny because Eddie Vedder has been in a lot of random stuff the past couple of years.
I just really hate that Sheriff
Harry S. Truman
is not going to be in it, you know.
Well, apparently we're retired from acting.
Yeah,
and
I just wish my wish would be like, oh, surprise, he actually is in the entire season, you know. Because I love that dynamic between the two of them. Like, that was one of my favorite parts of that show.
Yeah, so we'll have to see how that plays out. But, so I'm assuming that if they're still aiming for early 2017, we'll probably see some promo material for it sometime in the next few months. But
yeah, I'm looking for they've released like a couple teasers that have been, you know, nothing specific from the show. But I every time I'm like, I'm ready to see some footage from that.
So I think that was kind of all of the news to cover this past week. Beside that, moving into the things we've been watching. I haven't really had time to watch much of anything because I was out of town over the weekend and got back late Monday and did some work and stuff for the short film, some sound stuff. So I didn't really get a chance to watch much of anything. I have caught up on the show Mr. Robot, which is in season 2, which I've enjoyed. The second season started out pretty slow, but then it started to get back into the main plot. But that's a show I really enjoyed the visual style of it, and something that... If you heard about it and you're like, oh, it's on USA, they have all the shows about people's professions, like lawyer show, and
they do have that.
And
generic white guy job number 3.
Yeah,
TV
so
show.
All those shows. So this is actually pretty far from that and more in line with the prestige stuff you see on like AMC or HBO. So if it seems like something you'd be interested in, I recommend giving it a look because it's on the first season's on Amazon Prime Instant Video now, so you can catch up that way. But it's a show I'm enjoying and recommend checking out. It's basically just about hackers kind of going after the financial system.
What was the movie with the guy from Scream? that was in the hacker movie. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It's like a really shitty early 90s movie, and they're like computer hackers.
There's
a lot. Is it what it is?
With Angelina Jolie?
Yeah. And it's like hackers. They're all like super punk rock looking.
Yeah, I don't know who is in Scream from that, though.
I just always think of
Skeet Ulrich or Matthew Lillard. I don't know if they're in it.
Probably Matthew Lillard.
Yeah, it was Matthew Lillard.
He seemed like he would be in it.
Yeah, he was in it. He had like
he was in everything.
In the 90s to... When do you bring him back in more movies?
No. He hosted, I think, Skate TV on Nickelodeon, too. It was like a skate show from like 1990, because they were shot on reruns probably like 15 years ago.
I would love to go back and rewatch it. Just
it was
to see,
cool.
Just like, to see like what it was.
In high school, it was like old. You know, I was like almost 15 years old when I was in high school, and it was cool to watch. Like, it would be on every day.
Yeah. Which is funny how much different that the early 90s skating is compared to what's going on.
It was
now.
It was a really great show. Like it was awesome. But by the way, William, is Preacher over with now?
Yes, the first season is completed.
Do you think that probably won't be hitting Prime or anything anytime soon, will it?
Typically, so with all the AMC stuff, it usually hits Netflix a week or two before the next season premieres.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll probably be next year, like within a couple weeks of when the new season is going to come out, that it'll hit.
Isn't that show like really acclaimed? Or it seemed like...
Preacher? No, not really.
I thought a bunch of people liked it. I've heard a lot of good things about it.
I haven't really heard much of anything about it, aside from like two or three people I know. Like I think that it's going to be one of those shows that builds an audience over, you know, Netflix, more so than people watching it live, because it moved a little bit slowly. That's the type of thing I think that works better to watch all at once versus week to week.
Yeah.
Oh, I just seem like I've heard a whole lot of good things.
I mean, I don't know if it's... No. I mean, it's not on the same level.
The only thing I've heard really necessarily bad... Well, William, you said it may be better to binge watch, and then some of the like Preacher fans weren't necessarily thrilled that it was like a prequel to it, right?
Yeah, because
that was like the most complaints about it. I think.
Yeah, like not to spoil anything, but if you've read the novels, like I haven't read them, I've just talked to people that did. It seems as if the show ends like the very end of the season ends where the first issue covered in the comics, so it actually is mostly backstory. But you can, like I said, you can, if you have like AMC on demand or something, you can watch it now, or you can wait for it to hit Netflix. I think it works better watching it all at once because it does move a little bit slowly or, deliberately.
Mm-hmm.
But, so that's something that you can keep an eye out for. But, I haven't really watched anything else this week. So Derek,
As far as horror related, I haven't, and you know, like me and Sean, I think both watched Suicide Squad last weekend. But the Olympics have been going on, so that's what I've been watching a lot of.
Wait for somebody to die.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's one of those things, like, I'm like watching this, and then I've watched it every single time.
We're recording this early, too, so if something happens, know that no one has died in the Olympics yet.
Yeah, no,
there wasn't a poor taste joke.
The pool has turned green.
Oh, they got it fixed.
Oh, they did?
I think, yeah. They don't know why it turned green, though.
Did Michael Phelps piss in it?
No.
Yeah, it's the diving pool. So people are, you know, diving into like a bright green pool. It's and then yesterday they said like the major news stories from like the AP, the Associated Press, and like these different like major news outlets said that the Olympic pool turns green and smells like farts. It's like that's awesome. a good headline to have.
And then the Olympic Committee came out to say that chemistry is not an exact science. Like, oh yeah, well
no, I think it kind of is.
Yeah, but that's what they said. That was their excuse for it turning green.
No, I think it's basically just that either.
Oh, do you see the memes where people were like putting Kermit the Frog in it? And like they would have like Shrek sitting in it telling them to get out of a swamp. It was really stupid. The Kermit the Frog one was pretty good.
Yeah.
From the Muppet movie or whatever. I watched Suicide Squad, and it's a movie that exists, and I don't know, I mean, I'm not thinking a big, you know, we don't cover a whole lot of movies like that, but I'm interested in what Sean thinks, because going into it, you know, I was pretty, because even on the podcast I was excited for it, so I mean, like, I guess they put a lot of money into it, because every time I got anything on social media, I was targeted for it. I saw a bunch of commercials, and it came out, and it was just like, I don't know. It just felt like they took two different movies and put it together. And the worst thing I've ever seen on film in a major movie in the 26 years of my life was probably the Jared Leto Joker. And I understand why he's only in the movie for like 5 minutes.
But you have watched, I hate to bring it up, Cabin Fever, right?
Yes. Like the Joker, Jared Leto's performance was on par with any of the things those actors did in that movie. I mean, like
the Cabin Fever remake.
Okay,
the Cabin Fever
remake. I didn't think Jared Leto was good. No.
Oh,
and
it
I was laughing.
So
I was laughing in the theater kind of like, You know what I mean? It was kind of like, oh, man,
this
is really
dumb.
So this
was the performance that required him to send his co-stars used condoms and dead animals and things to try to be a method
actor. And that's the thing. That's the bad thing about it.
Yeah, and one thing I wanted to ask you about, because William doesn't watch any of these
movies. I've read the synopsis of it, and it's like not the spoiler thing, but it's like every single superhero movie ever where they all have to go to some beam in the sky and stop it before the world ends. And it's like, the next time somebody does that, slap him in the face. And tell them, okay, cut your budget by $50 million and make a real story.
There's this one scene I want to talk about in particular, which took me out of the movie. It almost ruined it for me. Like, it was on the verge of me being like, I'm ready to leave. The Joker has a mouth tattoo on his hand. And he puts his mouth up to his, like that. And it proceeds to laugh.
Well, it's not a great Joker laugh either.
No, it's terrible. And, like, having grown up, watched... You know, Mark Hamill was by far, in my opinion, the best Joker
the
as far as
voice
the anime, but just as far as longevity
goes. I think it's Cesar Romero from the.
I mean, I would have preferred them to have edited out Jared Leto and put in Cesar Romero because at least he had fun in it. Like Jared Leto, it was
the
not
thing
good.
About it. Yeah, that made me laugh. Like at it.
I mean, did it hurt you to watch that? Like
that?
I was like, oh my god, what? Who okayed this fire? Like my dad always wants to fire everybody from everything. So then he put my dad in charge of this movie so he could have fired everybody from everything except for Will Smith, Viola Davis, and Margot Robinson or whatever her name
Margot
is.
Margot Robinson.
I don't care. Yeah. Like, but, you know, the best part of the
and
movie...
And I like the head lady that was kind of in charge of the operation.
Oh, Viola Davis?
Was that who
yes.
that is? Yeah, she did a great job.
She was phenomenal. Yeah. Like, she is the female Nick Fury. I mean, like, you feel like she's... You don't want to... I don't know, like... On retrospective, thinking about movie, that was, she was probably the she sold it. Like,
she was great, yeah.
She was. She was very good.
Yeah, I mean, I enjoyed it, but I went in with super low expectations.
See,
like,
I didn't.
Just like Batman versus Superman. Yeah. I was like, all right, well, the reviews are terrible. Let's just see if I can get any enjoyment. And I got some enjoyment out of it, so I was like, okay, that's fine. It's like a day at the movies. I would probably watch it again, but only for, again, you know, for them three that you mentioned. Because
yeah, but like to me too, like saying that Margot Robbie, I keep calling her, I kept calling her
Margot
Kidder,
Robbie.
Whatever her name is. I kept calling
Margot
Kidder
from Superman.
DC. I kept calling her that the other day and my girlfriend's like, who's that? I'm like, oh, that's a lady from the '70s. But anyway, like those two, Will Smith and her, they did their job. Like they're going to be good. That's, you already know that. But other movies that like Batman versus Superman, bad reviews. I've really enjoyed it. X-Men Apocalypse, bad reviews, really enjoyed it. This one, so I kind of like, okay. I was like, yeah, I've enjoyed these other two movies whole lot. And this one obviously had the worst score of the two, so it's like, it's probably going to be the best one.
Yeah.
And, in, you know, the first half of the movie, if they had just done the first half, it would have been great. If they cut off, like, if it had been a 45 minute movie, it would have been one of the best of the year.
It was all flashbacks. Yeah, because that was the best
stuff. That was the best stuff. And then when they actually got into the action, like, they put the Boomerang character in there, and it's like...
Yeah, so it's like, you have, like...
If Tom Hardy would have been in it...
It would have been,
That would have had an awesome, like, trifecta of villains there. That would have been great. Because he was supposed to be in it. And
one other thing we talked about, too, we've talked about this, is accents. And a Southern accent... is the Swedish dude that played RoboCop, whatever his name is.
Joel Kinnaman, who is on The Killing and RoboCop.
Anyway, him and Margot Robbie both throughout the movie would just talk in a normal American accent, just like no... And then for some reason, like, because Harley Quinn, you know, has like a Jersey accent from the animated series.
I've heard she kind of slips in and out.
So it slips in and out of it through different parts of the movie, and it makes no sense. And RoboCop Man was trying so hard to be Brad Pitt from Inglourious Bastards, it was not funny. Like, that's when I heard him speak, I was like, you cannot be that Brad Pitt voice.
Joel Kinnaman also was on the show House of Cards and played an American, but like,
if he just did a normal American accent, like from The Killing, it's fine. But when he would be like, well, boys, it's like, no, quit it, stop.
So I think thing,
there was the whole thing was a big mess, but like I said, the whole movie was like, it was just kind of all over the place, but. Yeah. There was enough for me to enjoy it, to be like, okay, I got some enjoyment, but yeah, it was like, I don't want to sit here and defend the movie because...
What happened was what's the guy's that directed Ayers?
David Ayer.
Yeah, I think they just let him
do... Well, he did like End of Watch, which is great.
Yeah, but I think
and
they
he
just
wrote Training Day and...
Yeah, to me what it felt like is WB came in and was like, you know what, guys?
Well, they literally brought in a company to re-edit the movie, show both cuts, and then merged them.
Yeah, well, I think is they said, all right, you know what? Because if this movie had been more like a Deadpool-type movie where it was still in the expanded universe of, like, Fox X-Men movies, but it didn't directly relate to what was going on, it's fine. But they wanted to make it in that universe, so they kind of forced a lot of things, and I think that's where it came.
Well, it's all kind of ramshackle.
The Enchantress was.
So I think the problem, like I said, I haven't seen the movie. I've only read the reviews and got the basic plot outline, or read the entire plot outline. And I think this movie, I think a lot of movies after Deadpool took the wrong notes. So yep. The notes weren't, oh, an edgy adult superhero film is going to do gangbusters box office. Like, that's part of it. But the other part is kind of a scoped down universe where it's just like, hey, it's just like this kind of crazy irreverent character that's, you know, their own self is at stake and maybe one or two other people. Seems like all these movies have to have a light beaming into the sky that's like a portal or something that's going to destroy the world if they don't stop it. And every movie reverts to that. And then that immediately makes the budget shoot up to like $150 million and up.
Yeah.
If they just decide, cut that shit out, just make these movies focused on like a more small scale story, spend less money, then you can give the directors more freedom to do what they want because it's not as big of a risk. They don't have to make as much money to be profitable. And you don't have these huge, you know, messes on their hands.
Yeah. Well, I think one thing,
that they need to take away.
We're really disappointed with. Because, like, now Will Smith as Deadshot was awesome. Like, Will Smith was very good. And, like, Margot Robbie, very good. They got the right characters.
Margot Kidder was very good.
Yeah, well, she was in the original Superman, like, first before she went crazy. But anyway, like, they were very good in the roles. And to me, I think that the main reason this movie was made is I think they really want a Harley Quinn movie. So this is, like, their way to do it. But my thing is like, you finally get Will Smith in a superhero movie.
Yeah, this is probably one of the reasons he turned down Independence
Day,
too.
Yeah, but you finally get him, like, a character of this level, or an actor of his caliber going into the movie. Into the movie, and this is what we get. It's like, come on, man. Like, you know, because, like, Chris Evans and Robert Downey Jr. and them are now, like, huge.
They became big because of their superhero roles.
But this guy was, like, you know, for us, growing up in the 90s, this was, like, one of the biggest actors, you know. And, like, me and Sean, I think even you were talking about, like, anything Will Smith is in, for the most part, I would like to watch.
Well, in the 90s, he reached, like, a superstar status that very few see.
Yeah.
You know, like him, and Tom Cruise.
And another thing, too, is like, you know, it just kind of like, you don't see a whole lot of African Americans get roles like that where, like, in superhero movies. You know, it's not something.
They took a character that was traditionally a white character and had a black actor portray him, and no one cared.
No one cared because it was Will Smith.
Because they're like, oh, it's a really good, well known actor for kind of a minor role. That makes a lot of sense. Nobody cares. Unlike these other things where people are up in arms over, you know.
And there's very little kickback because, you know, like, internet warriors love to get on everything.
I think they exhaust themselves on Ghostbusters and then didn't have time to worry about anything else.
Yeah, well, they're still going on Ghostbusters, but that will be, like, something 20 years from now. Like, well, man, they ruined that movie. It's like, okay. But anyway, like, not to dump on too much, but I think it'd be fun. I think it'd be really interesting to see how it does this weekend in the box office because it did really good its first weekend.
Well,
it's
Friday to Saturday. The box office dropped a very large percentage, more than Batman v Superman or mostly every other superhero film, like from Friday to Saturday, the gross drop, which was indicating that people weren't super thrilled with it. So if it continues to see a decline over the course of the following weeks, it probably will have – it'll make enough money internationally. They'll keep moving on with their current plans, but it will not have made enough that was profitable and they're super
happy
with it.
Is it possible that DC will be what brings down, like, superhero franchises?
Well, in 2018, I think we looked at, there's an article where in 2018, like, from March to September, every single weekend, there's a tentpole blockbuster film.
Yeah.
And there's not enough dollars and people to make all of them profitable.
Well, like we said before, and I'm going back to this because the article I read, and it's just really interesting, it's on CNN, people see 5 movies a year. That's your average. You know, like people like us, I think I've already seen 10. Sean,
well, we see
you've seen them a lot.
Yeah,
so you've seen
them almost every weekend.
Yeah, so it's like we're the exception, you know. But your general, where are you making money from? 5 a year.
Your mom and pops.
Yeah, and like.
And next year there'll be like 5 Marvel and 5 DC.
Yeah, well, there's three Marvel movies next year. There's 2 DC movies. So there's 5 right there.
And they're just superhero movies.
Yeah, and that's not including anything else that comes out.
And then you
got
to figure, like, in 2018 and 17, you got the new Alien, you got the new Predator, you got all these tentpole franchises, you got Steven Spielberg's Ready Player One.
Yeah.
So you got all these big movies.
But, like, to what you said.
When does Avatar come out?
Oh, God, why are they
doesn't
doing
matter.
That?
There's so many of them.
Like, I wish they could just go back in time and erase the existence of Avatar. It was the worst movie ever made.
No, it wasn't the worst.
It was pretty bad. It was pretty. It was Dance with Wolves with blue people.
It was amazing special effects that like sold 3D in the theater.
Yeah, but like,
a story that had been told 100 times.
Yeah, story had been told 100 times and was very unoriginal and was poop. And people would just poop their pants when they watched it. And
have you guys seen Edge of Tomorrow?
No. No, I need to.
That movie is awesome.
Live, Die, Repeat?
Is that? Yeah, Live, Die, Repeat. And it's like,
I need to watch that.
It is the cool, like, Space Marine stuff from, you know, that's a little bit in Avatar and then from Aliens.
Yeah.
It's like that, but just that movie. And it's, like, awesome.
Can we talk about how Tom Cruise doesn't age in, like, 20 years?
My mom thinks he really aged in the new Mission Impossible.
I don't know. Like,
added on, she was like, "Oh yeah, he's getting older."
There's like something,
but no, he's doing very well for himself, yeah, considering he's a white guy.
Yeah.
Well, like he's in the new. You know what I mean? Like,
because they have those machines that suck all the thetans out and it just keeps them.
Oh yeah.
But like, yeah, he's in the new Jack Reacher movie or something coming out.
Yeah,
and it's like he's in
the most recent Mission Impossible.
No, I haven't.
Man, you haven't seen either, have you, William?
No, it's going to hit Amazon Instant.
Is that the airplane
soon.
One?
So good, yes.
Yeah, I want to watch it. It's going to hit Amazon Instant.
That's not
soon.
Ghost Protocol. It's Rogue Nation.
But it's just funny to me, so though. Good. I feel like he went from like a low for like a 10-year point in his career where he didn't do anything, and it's like 40s almost.
Well, no, what happened
and
is...
And now that he's in his 50s, he's like turning all these action.
No, what happened is he went up to War of the Worlds, was the jumping on the couch stuff, and then that kind of knocked him down a peg for a while, and he's had to build his way back up by just... You know, like falling into
when was
these.
He?
Well, too, he's a producer on Mission Impossible. I think that's kind of helped him stay kind of at that level. You know, I think the first Mission Impossible was the first film he was a producer on. So that franchise has been his since the beginning.
Or no, I think, was it War of the Worlds? I know it was Mission Impossible 3 that came out right after the couch jumping. And then people thought when he went on Oprah, he's like, I love this woman. And he's like jumping up and down.
Yeah.
Like that came out, that happened before Mission Impossible 3. And people thought that hurt that it's domestic gross. Even though it made money, it didn't make as much.
What year did you jump on the couch?
Is that like 2005-ish?
I know it was referenced in Arrested Development.
Wasn't it when Batman Begins? Was coming out.
That was 05 Begins was.
So somewhere in that era, but...
I just remember they referenced in Arrested Development because some man that was a scientist was talking about how...
Yeah,
I can't.
But, does anybody else watch anything?
Yeah, we watched two movies this week. Next week's podcast will be Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2. We were going to try to record both those today. Don't know if we'll be able to. But, so I watched that in the fly, and that took up a lot of time. And then, I'm trying to think if I watched... You know, after watching Suicide Squad, I... got a copy of Batman, that Ultimate Edition. And that's a film, there's some dumb stuff in there, and I won't, like, fault anybody for not liking it or thinking it's really stupid, like, parts of it. But for me, that's a film I'm more watching with my heart than my mind, and I enjoy watching that movie. Like, I've only seen it twice. Saw it once in theaters and was, like, pleasantly surprised based on the reviews. And this time that I watched it, I liked it even more. And I was like, okay, I was like, I could watch this again right now. Like, I just enjoy watching that movie, even though there's, like, things wrong with it and you can point out. I just think it moves fast. I like Zack Snyder's style he uses in it, and like I love Batman in it.
Yeah, I'll say this, like one of the, you know, just real quick, not to get a big spiel, like Jared Leto, I was gonna give him a chance with the Joker because of Heath Ledger and Ben Affleck with Batman. Like I was very, I don't know if it was on the podcast, very,
you were very dismissive of his casting.
Yeah, I was very dismissive, and then I watched it and I was like, I'll eat all the crow.
You're like, I'm going to stick this shit in my mouth.
Yeah,
just
like,
eat like
I was
a sandwich.
Completely wrong. Like, Ben Affleck as Batman is one of the... He's my favorite by far. And
He's the best actor that's ever been cast. And I'm just joking.
No, but like, I really liked Christian Bale's, you know, and Michael Keaton.
They just made Batman a huge badass in this movie.
Yeah, and
I don't think Batman's a hard role to nail, really.
Yes, it is. Because like...
Aside from George Clooney... Who wasn't really his fault.
George Clooney had the look. He just was in a bad nipple suit.
Somebody made the comparison that Suicide Squad is the third missing film of Joel Schumacher's Batman trilogy where forever, because it has like that same soap neon style in the flashbacks and stuff. They said, especially the flashback things, they build Gotham City as being like part of that same world. Almost.
Well, it feels like just looking at the promotional materials, they mistook people having tattoos for personality.
Yeah.
And they thought like this, they built like this edgy world. It's like, we talked about in Lights Out, the generic mid-2000s Rockers. White people rock.
Yeah.
And they took that kind of same view to like, well, if all these villains have a bunch of like edgy tattoos that say, ha, 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 ha.
Well, I want to say one thing, too, though. Like, with Jared Leto taking the Joker role, you have Heath Ledger. And I think for anybody, that role that he did is going to be very hard to take. You know, you're going to be criticized for it. But the way that he did it was garbage. It was hot garbage. It was poop. You know, I don't know. It just was not good. But anyway, you know, we're going on about that movie.
Yeah, he should not be Freddy Krueger, basically.
No.
All right, so any non-superhero movies anybody's watched?
No, it's just hard not to talk about those because they've been dominating the box office this year. Yeah. You know,
but I feel like so many other people are bitching about it so much that everyone's opinions are ingrained at this point, and you're not going to sway anyone to.
No. People are petitioning to get rid of Rotten Tomatoes,
which is funny because Rotten Tomatoes is owned by the same parent company as Warner Brothers. So
yeah.
And it's just a review aggregation site. They're not making the reviews.
And one other thing too to point out real quick on the way that Rotten Tomatoes works is that 3 out of 3 or 3 out of 5 can either
positive.
It's positive, yes. So, like, with Ghostbusters...
All it is, percentage of positive reviews. Yes. It's not a weighting of 50% of the reviews are positive, and they, on average, got, you know, 7 out of 10. Like, it's just saying, out of 100 reviews, 50 of them were 2 out of 5, and 50 of them were 4 out of 5.
Basically, should you go see it or not, how good it is based on percentage.
There's also audience score, too, that people forget about Rotten Tomatoes, which is maybe a little more important.
Cinema score is the one that's more important, which, you know, typically if you get like a B- or whatever, you're not going to have great business. Anything below that has very bad business. And most of your, like, four quadrant big blockbusters are A or A minus.
So if you're Pluto Nash, you didn't do very good. I just remember so many commercials for that movie when I was younger, and it was so bad.
Eddie Murphy.
Movie. I don't remember what the title is, though. All right, moving into The Fly, so you got it up on your phone.
Yeah, so we're going to move into The Fly from 1986. The Fly. Directed by David Cronenberg, starring Jeff Goldblum and Gina Davis. Now, this is a movie that if we've mentioned before, like when you watch like the AMC Fright Fest or whatever it's called that comes on around Halloween.
Tentpole movie.
Movie, a tentpole.
Whatever.
A tentpole.
I want
a tentpole where you have a tent been around, built
tent
around
pole,
a
tentpole. Yeah.
You dig a little pool in the ground and you put like a tent over it. And
hey, if you were in California, let's sell that.
Let's make that a product. But this movie is one that if you watch those horror movie marathons, this is always shown. And I've seen this movie quite a number of times, but mostly it's on TV, so it's only probably, you know, I've seen it, not from beginning to end, but just seen it, like, probably 20 times or so.
Yeah, do real quick, remember the time we watched
it? From beginning to end, I've only watched it about 4 times.
There was, like, one time we were really young, we watched over one of our aunt's houses, and the power went out and scared the crap out of us. Do you remember that? That's, like, the first thing I think about when I watch this movie.
I love this movie as a kid. Like, I watched it a ton.
Which
when
I shouldn't
younger.
Have been. I was, like, so young. I should have watched
this
movie.
I was very young, too. I don't know why. But
in this movie, had a lot of Jeff Goldblum in underwear.
Yeah. Jeff Goldblum loved to get naked in this movie.
That's my penis.
Yeah.
So the main thing that you have to talk about in this movie is, I mean, well, actually, just the brief synopsis. We'll do full spoilers because this is a movie I'm sure everybody
has seen.
30
years old.
And if you haven't, go watch it because it is one of my favorite.
Well, I guess, too, when we release this podcast, it will be on the 30th anniversary,
Yeah,
right?
I think it was going to be on Monday.
Oh, we release it on Tuesday.
So yeah,
it'll be out Monday before the end of the night. But,
but anyway,
officially it goes
that's why we're covering this. 30th anniversary came out in August, whatever, 15th, I think, of... 1986.
Yeah, so this is a movie that's kind of like a touchstone for a lot of people just in the effects. So, you know, the basic story is that Jeff Goldblum's character, Seth Brundle, makes a teleportation device that teleports items from one chamber to another. He gets in it himself, and a fly gets in with him that he doesn't notice, and it splices their DNA at a genetic level, and he starts turning into a human flying monster.
Brundle fly.
Which is kind of like, I wonder if there is a actual Brundlefly now, if somebody's ever renamed a species they found.
If you really like this movie and you also like Dexter's Laboratory, they did a really good segment making fun of this
movie. I remember
movie.
His Dexter being a fly. Kind
yeah,
of
well, he did, it was the same yeah. thing. Yeah. Yeah, it was a really good segment.
And then there's the original Fly from the 50s, which is a pretty different film from this one.
Vincent Price.
Did you all watch, have you ever watched, seen that one?
Yes.
I've seen it.
It's been a while.
I was young. Probably around this, I think I may have watched that because I watched this when I was younger.
Yeah.
And I liked that too because the ending of that was a little disturbing.
He's like a little fly person. And
yeah, as cheesy as that film is now, like I still appreciated it then and liked it. And I kind of want to revisit it.
Because the Dexter's version's more of the Vincent Price and not the 80s.
Yeah, so this is, you know, one of David Cronenberg's.
Dexter's teeth doesn't fall out.
No.
So this is Cronenberg's most financially successful film. And it was also critically successful and won an Oscar for the effects makeup, which, you know, this movie, the effects are the one thing that you've probably seen from if you haven't watched it from beginning to end, and that there's so many, like, iconic effect scenes in it. You know, Jeff Goldblum regurgitating, like, liquid onto stuff and his ear falling off and all the stuff. And, like, I was reading earlier about the scenes that have been cut from it and things like that. And then there's, like, a scene where he makes a monkey cat that's, like, deformed that he has to kill. And he has, like, there's a scene, like, where he grows, like a fly's leg out of his side that he, like, bites off with his own teeth. And there's, like, a... stuff like that. So there's stuff that's not in the final version because they thought that it would distance people from the character and make him less sympathetic if he's kind of doing these experiments on animals, even though he kind of just turns a baboon inside out at one point by putting it through the machine. But
Gina Davis don't even care.
Yeah, like, I would be upset about that.
She's like, let's eat it.
But, you know, it's a movie where...
That scene when that monkey hand comes up and hits the thing is so good. Like, that simple effect. Like, they didn't even have to show the monkey if they didn't want to. Granted, it just, like, ups that scene. But just having that paw, like, hit the thing and just wipe across it. Yeah. Oh, it's so good.
Yeah, so, you know, the story, you know, it's a pretty basic story. Jeff Goldblum meets Gina Davis, a character who's a writer. And then he tells her about his invention and shows it to her. And then... they engage in a romantic relationship, and then he tests the machine on himself. And, you know, the movie, like, up to the point that he goes through the machine, you know, it's pretty standard fare. But once he goes through the machine, then it's full on Cronenberg with the body horror stuff that so many people have tried to replicate that in different forms since then. But I think that, like, the new Fantastic Four they made a year or so ago was trying to go for the body horror vibe, but didn't really get it at all. Like, this Cronenberg stuff, like, you could imagine, like, being the person that's turning into the fly and how scary that would be, or, like, it being somebody you care about.
The body horror stuff, like, that's what gets, like, ghosts don't get to me, nothing. You know what I mean? Like I said, we've mentioned before, not a lot, like, really scares us when we watch movies, but the body horror stuff, like, affects me on, like, a more visceral level, you know? Like, my lizard brain is like, no, that would be, you know, that's not right.
Well, I think,
so, like,
I just,
as a kid, too, I was like, and even still, some of these scenes to me, I'm like, oh, shit, you know?
But I was thinking, too, because, like, even, like, with ghost stuff, like, you're kind of, but you hear real-life stories of, like, just terrible stuff that happened to people, like, as much as I don't like Eli Roth and some of his stuff, didn't Cabin Fever base off the fact that he got that disease or something like that?
He got some type of fleshing disease.
And he's like shaven and it actually did that to him. So it's like, that's why it affects you, because, well, nobody gets mutated into a fly. There are some terrible things that can happen.
And two, you know, Cronenberg, his style, especially with this, it's very matter of fact. It's not super slick. This isn't shot with a series of, you know,
there's no montage.
Yeah, you know, even still, like, even when Jeff Goldblum, Brendel, is, like, running on the ceiling and stuff, it's not, like, close shots of his feet. Like,
no.
It's just shot, like, if you were in this room watching this happen, it's very, you know, matter-of-factly, and it just kind of brings more realism and weight to it, because you're just watching it happen, it's not overly stylized, and it just has a more gritty feel to it.
Well, and too, the effects on this, all these practical effects, like, we had, I know, like, Sean and I and a few other people had seen The Thing in theaters with a sold out house at a theater, luckily, that does midnight screenings. And, you know, people were into that movie, but a lot of people weren't really affected by the effects in the way that you would have been if you had seen it when it came out. I think with The Fly, I think the practical effects hold up a little bit better than most of the stuff from the era, because it's a person and it's something.
Yeah. Well,
I think that everything really, but, like,
maybe the very, very
suit
end.
He's wearing some because it's a little bulky. Yeah. You know, I would.
I think that looks infinitely better than what a CG creation.
Oh, 1,000. I think what makes it more effective, though, is the fact that it just happening to a person.
Well, I think, like, too, the fact you see so much of Jeff Goldblum normal before he starts to transform makes it all the more impactful.
And in 2016, having watched this again, Jeff Goldblum has been a staple in film for a lot of my life. So it's like you relate to the character just because you like Jeff Goldblum a little bit.
Yeah. And it's one of those things where, you know, like I said, most of the effects, like the teeth falling out and the ear falling off and all that. Like I said, like the actual suit that he wears is a little bit bulky towards the,
I think,
his, like, before he turns into the full on puppet.
But the most disturbing part about his body parts falling off is that he doesn't care and he just keeps them in his medicine cabinet.
Yeah.
And he's like, and Gina Davis comes at one point, he's like, oh, I got a Brundle
museum or whatever.
Yeah. And you want to look, and she's like, no. And it's just like, that's the most disturbing part. It's like, his teeth fall out, and he's like, oh, and he just puts them up
as
in the
a kid.
Cabinet.
Like, so many of those images were vivid. Like, his ear, and especially sitting in the cabinet, his teeth falling out. like all of that stuff as a kid, like stuck in my mind, now, like, even to this day.
A scene that's not in this movie, and I don't think it was in the script at any point either, was his penis falling off. That would have been horrific.
Well, I kind of allude to that in his medicine cabin, because there's something that looks like that.
I think it might just
there.
Be fingers, because his fingers went to like the three mandible things.
But they fused.
Things.
But yeah. Anyway, you don't really know for sure, but there's a bunch of disturbing body parts in the medicine cabin.
But they left out that scene if they, because like I was reading earlier, like the script, like Cronenberg rewrote the script from the prior draft. So he kind of changed a little bit of things, and there were some scenes like where he was going to attack a woman and like regurgitate the goo on her head and like kill her and eat her, but they cut that out because they thought that that went too far.
I mean, it's great. Yeah, see, for some reason, I let a friend borrow the Blu-ray, but every time I'd put it in, I would just watch the movie and not the special features, you know? But it's great to hear about how much they've cut out, because this film like has so much. Once it gets started, it just amps up in like scene after scene of just things that, you know, are just so well done and affect you so much. And it's just like nonstop. You know, it's like the chest pressure scene from Alien, only every other scene after, you know, he starts transforming. Yeah. Like it just continues to amp it up throughout the entire
film.
And
I'll kind of compare this to Werewolf in London, just on one aspect that it doesn't drag. Like I don't watch this movie.
It's 95 minutes.
Yeah, it's 95 minutes. Mm-hmm. And another thing too is you have two really good actors in it. You have Gina Davis and Jeff Goldblum. So their interactions keep it pretty interesting. And another good scene is the arm wrestling scene.
Yeah, breaks the guys.
Yeah, but like
again, Cronenberg, everyone is so inventive, and it's a different type of style of body horror.
Yeah,
and it's just a nonstop barrage.
But the funny thing is, like now looking at the Jeff Goldblum's like the Brundle at that point, he just kind of looks like a meth head.
Yeah,
you know, because he's got like facial sores.
Yeah. Sores. And then John Getz is Stathis Borens. Mm. Like he was a character that went from being like kind of a creeper stalker, really. To in the end, like a semi-hero, minus
a hero for the right or wrong reasons,
minus like a hand and a
which
foot,
I mean when he
which are alternating, it's not the same side of his body.
Yeah, the hand and then the is so bad, and then even the foot because you can see it breaking at the ankle.
Yeah,
you know, like that was just.
But I think one thing too that makes that scene so effective is like the fact that. Like he's doing it while just looking at him, you know. Like he's not doing it fast. He like melts his hand off, and then he uses his foot to drag the gun back over, and then he melts his foot and just looks at him. And obviously he's about to melt his face, and then it gets stopped. Mm-hmm. But
and it's one of those things too. Like you see, like the runtime of it. Like a lot of times when we watch movies for the podcast, I look at the runtime of the movies. I'm like, oh come on, it's 2 hours. Like a lot of movies don't earn their runtime and just put in extraneous stuff. Whereas, like, this movie, like we said, it's pretty straightforward, and it mostly takes place at his apartment.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's very few places. Yeah.
Which is, you know, one of those things where it's probably budgetary and script reasons and things like that. Because if you have him flying, I think if you had him flying around as, like, a fly person killing a bunch of people, it would have lessened the impact and made it a different type of movie.
Yeah. Because it takes the intimacy out of it.
Yeah, and this is about two people.
Victim to victim, like a Friday the 13th.
But being focused on just, like, an interpersonal relationship. That kind of grounds it for a lot of people. It's like, oh, like if this person that you, you know, loved or whatever is starting to turn into a creature, like how would you deal with that? And then there's the whole pregnancy aspect where Gina Davis's character is pregnant and she doesn't know if she got pregnant before or after he went through the portal and then what would come out of her. And then she has the dream that was the maggot baby.
Mm-hmm. Have you guys watched the sequel?
Yes.
I've seen bits and pieces of it. I read about it.
I watched that a lot as a kid.
Ultra
too.
Gory.
Yeah, I watched that. I feel like both those were on USA a lot when I was younger.
Yeah, I've seen it. It's just been a while.
I liked it as a kid. I haven't watched it since then. But
the gore is very good, but it makes up for a lack of everything with just an excessive amount of it.
Yeah, there's a couple really good scenes in that from what I remember.
And too, like I was reading up on it, like Jeff Goldblum says he didn't want to do a sequel, but he would be up for like a cameo.
Yeah.
And Gina Davis is on board with the sequel until they decided like how long her character would be in that movie and what happened to her. So that's why they like recast her character and stuff like that.
But they still but Jeff Goldblum.
There's a videotape.
In it.
There's a videotape of him. I think that was like unused stuff from the first film.
And they use the one scene where he's like showing how they eat food, how he eats food, and So he's
wanted to revisit that because I did. There were some key moments of that I liked, and I just remember having that. Distinct, you know, it was made in what, 1989 or something. Like it just had that distinct 1980s feel of a place from, you know, like the hospital. It takes place a lot in a hospital, I think.
It's like, well, it's like the facility that made the pods. Okay,
For me, it just felt like a place that I would have visited as a kid. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, it just, I don't know. I had a very...
What's the movie with Robin Williams where he ages really quick? Jack?
Jack, yeah.
It's kind of like Jack, but instead of aging really fast, you're just turning into a fly.
Yeah.
And that's the second.
And apparently, too, the transportation pods were based on a Ducati motorcycle that Cronenberg had. Because the pods themselves look kind of just sinister, you know, like on the cover.
Yeah.
Just having the pod itself looks kind of sinister and dangerous. And I think a lot of times in modern movies, everything's far too slick and like inspired by Apple or...
Yeah, these looked like something that you would fit in an Aliens movie.
You would find those in a busted-ass warehouse somewhere downtown. Yeah. You know, you could open the door and expect those, too.
I could just almost expect it to be in the background of like an Alien movie, Sigourney Weaver walking by. And I liked that look, too.
Yeah, so the look of the movie, like I said, I think that the special effects, for the most part, I think they hold up better than a lot of movies of the era, even though those movies' effects are what I love, like The Thing and all that. Those are my favorite movies. But, like, I love the effects and everything, but I think today, to some people who are used to the... photorealistic approach is taken, but via
goofy.
CGI. So it's a different type of effect, but I think this mostly holds up to people. Like, you could show this to a group of 16-year-olds that haven't seen it.
And they would get a huge reaction out of
but
it.
But I was saying, too, like, even though it does take the half the movie to get to where he goes through the pond, just the fact that you have such good actors in makes it go smoother.
There's kind of the mystery, and it's interesting because she's trying to discover, just like the audience, like, oh, what is this? After you've seen it once, of course, you know.
Yeah.
But still, you like seeing her discover and then him being like almost nonchalant about it. Like, oh, yeah, it's going to change the world. And he's like, well, those other people are lying. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he's just kind of – he's a very interesting, intelligent character before he even turns into the fly.
Yeah,
so you could watch a whole movie just about – them two, really.
Yeah. And then, like, as he turns into the fly, one of the more interesting points is, like, here's skin's falling off, and his ear and teeth are missing, and he wants to become a fly politician.
You know?
And that's, like, a very Goldblum moment to me, you know? He's, like, I want to be the first fly politician.
Yeah, because he's talking about, like, how flies, like, he can start to feel that he's being driven by instinct that he can't control versus, you know, rational thought. And, you know, so you have those elements, and all that stuff, you know, just adds up to the movie. You know, because, you know, he's still somewhat sympathetic even when he is the fly, because you know that...
It's not him. It's the fly part taking over.
Yes, you know, the fact that he's been modified. And, you know, like I said, too, there's a lot of good practical effects, like him climbing the walls, all that stuff. Like, I feel like if people did this today, like, I think this is something they should not try to remake or redo at all, because I
mean,
think...
how do you top it? You know, it's...
Because you do...
Yeah, there's no
this
point.
This is like Psycho.
Yeah,
you know,
and
like,
another thing, too, is
what do you do?
Not only is it just a great film, it also won an Academy Award. So it's like, if you come out and you remake it, you're going to get a guy directed Resident Evil to do it, and it's going to, because he's very good at setting movies in basements, and it's
going
to be pretty.
I think this is a movie.
Going back to the basement, the new Resident Evil. Did you see the trailer for it?
Yeah, they literally killed a person.
They're going back to it, and the hive person is back talking, saying,
so the
you know, welcome back, Alice.
The thing that I thought was the dumbest part of that movie was, like, not to get too far of a detour, but Resident Evil was set, the first one's in a mansion, the second one's in a small town. And you have all these, like, interesting locations you can use. And they made the first movie be set in an underground catacomb, which is the exact same setting they decided to use for Aliens vs. Predator, which
is
directed by the
same
guy.
Movie.
It has some of the same actors.
And they die in the same way.
So you have, like, that idea.
And one actress has
really
long nipples.
You don't want to get in that. But the...
that's a fact, though. You just watch
it. But I think, like, with The Fly, it's more of... a movie that a non-horror genre fan could sit down and watch.
Oh, The Fly?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and too,
it's
so gross.
It's so gross that, like, people might be grossed out by it. I could see, like, when this came out, people leaving the theater midway through.
Yeah.
And you could see them talking about this a lot at work.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And, like
I saw that...
You never said what the box office was for this.
Made around $40 million.
No, it made 60.
U.S.
Oh, well, don't do the U.S. crap. Do the world.
Well, the box office is different now. So the gross in the U.S. was $37 million.
Yeah.
And
according to Wikipedia,
and what was the budget?
It was 60.
Probably like 15, 20.
The budget was estimated at 15.
Oh, so you know, they remade it nowadays. What would happen is Blue Light in the Sky, Jeff Goldblum would try to turn, kind of like Amazing Spider-Man, they would try to turn the entire city of Los Angeles into flies.
Yeah, like
or something.
The today's thing would be like he would figure out a way to do it to everybody, make everybody into fly people, and they have to stop them, and there'd be like a light in the sky.
And then the army would come.
And it'd be a $500 million production.
So yeah. Luckily they did not go in that direction. Just kind of like a,
it's a very localized event. It really only affected three people.
And then one person really didn't have to be affected by it if he didn't want to be.
Yeah, I was saying it affected four people because he also had sex with a prostitute type woman.
And, but at the same time, too, it was like it. The film was based around something that would have a larger effect on the world. You know what I mean? Yeah. That's what's interesting about it, too, because, you know, this would affect everybody. Like, oh, imagine if the world, there was teleportation. You know what I mean? It's like, and he kind of goes into detail about the significance of it. So it's not just like, oh, yeah, teleportation. And he's like, you know, it breaks all boundaries and borders and everything. So there's a lot of things to kind of think about that the film brings up. And then there's also a lot of, I guess, emotions to go through as far as what if you were, you know, him turning into this fly. Like, there's so many things that kind of, I guess, pull you in and gross you into this film. And like I said, the fact that it's just shot very matter-of-factly and it doesn't, not super style, it's a lot of substance.
Yeah, that's the thing. I just think they couldn't have picked two better actors to be in it.
Or a director.
It was perfect.
And I think, too, like, I've seen some people point out, like, with something like the guy, like I said, Josh Trank, who directed the Fantastic Four, he went from doing Chronicle, which is, like, you know, a pretty relatively low-budget film, to doing this huge film. With Cronenberg, he had made a number of films before he got to do The Fly. So I think it helped him in this movie to have made smaller budget movies and really define a style and what he was about before he got a larger budget at the time. Because if you were to adjust like the $15 million from them to today, you know, it's at least like a $30 million, which for horror is a pretty big budget even still today.
Yeah.
So before he got to do this, you know, kind of big budget mass market film, he got to, you know, do all the stuff before that, like Scanners, all the things
Rabbit,
that he did. The
kind of Videodrome. I love Scanners.
Stuff that he did to build up his rapport and like his fan base and, you know, his style. So I think, you know, bringing in kind of an auteur that perfectly fits this film benefited it. And, like, I think they'd had different people that they talked. Like, they talked to Cronenberg and he wasn't available, so they talked to somebody else. And then that person had to drop out of the project. And then Cronenberg was available, so they brought him on board because he was working on an adaptation of Total Recall before this got made. And then he ended up not doing it, which went to Paul Verhoeven, and then which, of course, had Arnold Schwarzenegger in it.
Arnold.
Which that movie could have been a little bit different, too, if you had Cronenberg on it. But I think him and this movie were perfect matches of material. And like I said, something I don't think they should try to replicate. If anything, just take inspiration from this for something modern. But even then, I think you could still, like, this movie, not a lot dates it aside from some of the clothes and
yeah, because
and the computer interface. But it does have a version of Siri on there. So.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
Well, like, but I think another thing, too, that really helps this movie out as far as not making it dated is, like, while the clothing, but it's some of the stuff that Jeff Goldblum was wearing in this movie
is kind of
popular nowadays. Like, the tie he's got, like, the knit tie
he'd be kind of a hipster.
Yeah. Oh, another thing, too, I loved in the movie is very Goldblumish, too, is she's like, do you ever change clothes? And he's like, no, I got a bunch of clean clothes in a closet, and everything's the same. So
yeah, his suits are all the same jackets and shirts and pants.
So that kind of reminds me of like Doug the cartoon, because his entire closet was all the same, like Dexter's laboratory.
Well, I think,
is the
like
same,
in the movie, he says it's based on Einstein, who just had the same clothes.
Yeah, it is. But just funny to me is like
expend any energy thinking about
it. He even had like 10 pairs of the same shoes. You could just own one.
Which, here's the thing. I'm not against owning pairs of the same shoes, because if you get a pair you really like and they're going to wear out, and
that's
you go
like
ahead and get some while they make them.
A lot of shoes.
Yeah, he had like the bottom of his closet.
No, he had like at least like five pairs.
Yeah, of the same. Not including the ones he had on.
So you know, with this movie, you know, of course, you know, you got peak Goldblum and Gina Davis and special effects and everything that kind of makes this movie what it is. Yeah. It makes it something that's really easy to rewatch and one of the rare movies that critics and audiences like that still holds up. Because a lot of these horror films are retroactively liked by critics now, but they were not liked.
They were hated at the time.
This one of the rare ones were like, oh, people liked it when it came out. It didn't take 30 years for people to come around to it.
Yeah. It's kind of one of those movies I always forget about because, like you were saying, like it's always kind of shown on the AMC like Horror Fest stuff. So I guess one part of me kind of associates it with being a lesser film because of that.
Because it's around like all those sequels
and it's something I've watched so often through my life, and you know, you watch it again, you're like, oh wait a minute, this is actually probably one of the better ones. You know, this is definitely one of the better movies of the 80s, you know.
Yeah, it's definitely a classic that you have to kind of go back to.
But I think it's just forgotten about in my mind just because it's always on these different I've watched it so much. Maybe that makes me think it's
like
lesser.
Yeah, you might get associations with these lesser films that screen around, like the fourth and fifth Halloweens, and not that, like there are some things I like about those, but they're obviously not on the same level plateau as The Fly, so
or anywhere near as grotesque or disturbing. You know, because you got Michael Myers in the fifth movie just walking around, flowing a knife. You know,
like, I would say like, you know, like from the '80s, like. Like, it's kind of hard to categorize these different horror films because they're all so different. But I would say, like, The Thing is more... The Thing and, like, The Fly are kind of, like a similar tier.
What about, like, The Shining? Would you put it The Fly with The Shining? On?
I think the sci-fi. I mean, I think that they're, like, The Shining and a lot of these movies are all, like, on a plateau is above everything else. But there's, like, different subcategories. Yeah. The Shining's a much different film than The Fly and not really comparable. Yeah.
But I just... The only reason I can put these in the same group is, like, The Shining, American Werewolf in London, The Fly, The Thing. I think those are a lot of movies that you can show to modern audiences and still keep their attention, whereas I really think that like with Halloween I think you would struggle. Yeah, you know,
because like I think it's different because those movies that are based on like high-minded sci-fi concepts that like The Thing,
well, The Shining's not.
Well, The Shining, you know, is also kind of like there's ghosts and all this stuff.
It just it's just a creepy
movie, as opposed to Halloween is more about a straightforward slasher. But
I think
it's been aped so much and amped up so much over time that if you went back and watched the original one, it seems tame by comparison.
But on the same thing,
to nothing's really redid The Shining.
That it'd be easier to keep people's audience to the original Nightmare on Elm Street and Friday the 13th. You know, because
I don't know about the original Friday the 13th.
Yeah, maybe not the original. Yeah, but definitely the second. But you know,
yeah,
like
Nightmare on Elm Street, I think that holds up better than the original Halloween for new audiences.
Yeah, for new audiences, I think a lot of these. But you're talking about movies are made in different eras. But this is
we're also talking about these hypotheticals we haven't actually tested. So
yeah, this is all hypothetical. But I know just for me, just as a 26-year-old adult, I get bored and I watch this movie. And like my girlfriend came home halfway through it, and she's like, "What the hell are you watching?" Because she came in the scene when he's like melting the food and it's a disturbing movie.
Well,
but
to put into context, Halloween had like a $300,000 budget and then this had a $15 million budget.
Yeah,
so
you know, you look at the actors at the point when they had him in it
50 times the budget.
Yeah, it goes to the flop. I'm saying is there's a lot of movies that we watch that are older, like even the original Texas Chainsaw. It's rough to get through the beginning of it.
Yeah. We'll be talking about the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 on the next podcast.
But not the one with McConaughey, right? He was in 17 or whatever
he
was.
He was in 4?
I think 4, yeah.
That came out
did
in
he
the
say
90s.
All Right,
had Renee Zellweger. So a weird cast. So any final thoughts on The Fly before we wrap things up?
It's a very Goldblum movie. Like, it just Goldblum is the best Goldblum.
I want that to be a thing. A very Goldblum movie.
Yeah,
it's like a very Merry Christmas.
Yeah. You know, it's just like, if you love Jeff Goldblum.
Well, and a very Cronenberg.
Yeah.
Too, you know.
But I just love movies like where they just let the actors and actresses be themselves. And like Goldblum is just, I don't know how to describe
awesome
it.
He's awesome because he'll be in like these huge blockbuster movies. Like he was in Jurassic Park and Independence Day and all this stuff. But then he also does like a one-off episode of the FX show The League, which is tiny budget or some like indie movies or stuff.
I mean, he does all the Wes Anderson, Wes Anderson or a lot of Wes Anderson stuff.
Like The Life Aquatic, one of my favorite scenes is they get a three-legged dog from the Pirates and like Jeff Goldblum's like, bad dog, and starts hitting it with the newspaper.
It was somewhere like on Facebook or somewhere, somebody said that one of their friends ran into Jeff Goldblum.
I bet that'd be a weird experience.
They said, like, I love your movies. He's like, I bet you do. And he walked off.
But that's just, that's just a very Goldblum thing.
Like, that to me, like, you're like, oh, that's being a jerk. It's like, no, that's an appropriate response.
Yeah. Well, he's a very awkward individual, too.
I can imagine,
like, on Conan or on, what was he on, the BBC show, crap with the draft cars. I can't think of what's
called. Top Gear.
He was on there. He's just a very bizarre individual.
He was also on an episode of Late Show with James Corbin or whatever. Late Show.
James Corden.
And for whatever reason, that episode, they like went into they knocked on some doors in a neighborhood. Like the show starts out, they knock on some doors in like a neighborhood and then ask people, hey, can we like do our show here? And they move the whole set into somebody's house like in the middle of the night. And then Jeff Goldblum was in like one of those episodes. So he comes in the house, you know, and people are like freaking out and everything. And they're just sitting on their couch having the late show. And he was like, he's just like being awesome in it, you know?
And one thing too, like, I'm talking about Gene Davis real quick, because I really enjoy a lot of the stuff she's in.
She did a great job in this.
But but for me, maybe it's because this is a movie that's shown a lot when I was in elementary and middle school. But for me, Gina Davis is always associated with League of Their Own. Like, every time I see her, that is like the movie I think about.
Beetlejuice.
Yeah, and Beetlejuice. But I said, just for me, like when I was in elementary school, we watched League of Their Own so much.
Well, too, like, and you know, just the direction of this movie and the way it was shot, like, it didn't overly sexualize, like, she was a sexual being. But she wasn't sexualized or
they had Jeff Goldblum being the more sexualized one in this movie.
Yeah, walking around in his tighty whities.
Yeah, or like naked when he's in the pod and stuff. So like she didn't get, she was not a weak character. She just had hard decisions to make.
If this film would have been made today, it had Jeff Goldblum still, you know, be naked in the beginning, mostly naked, but they would have like CGI'd his body like Captain America to make him real scrawny. That way. You know what I mean?
That's so
what
he comes out pumped up, and then they would have
what they
whatever.
Would have done. They would have tried to. Like,
they would have him dating Megan Fox or some you know actress who typically.
But like
gets,
the thing about Gina Davis is like she's like a very pretty woman, but she's not like her and Orla Goldblum are like overly attractive. You know what I'm saying? They're not like. So, and a lot of these times, like I said, they're going to put Megan Fox in it. Or they're going to put these ridiculous people.
They're
going to
put. They're going to get all these people that have amazing physiques and all this stuff.
Yeah,
like,
but
CrossFit
his
physiques. Yeah, like where it's. Like the dude that played Chris Hemsworth that played Thor, like when they talk about their workout regimens, it's like those dudes' lives must suck because it's all just like eating like.
Hey, look, if they're going to pay me millions of dollars, I would.
Well,
do
okay, take it back. They don't suck. It's just they have like a regimen. Like they do like take a bunch of eggs and blend them and drink raw egg.
You know,
egg
my
milk,
life sucks
or,
so bad. I'm getting paid money and a chef's making this for me. It
but
sucks.
Like, but it would like
to an extent.
Like Hugh Jackman, like when he's shooting like the X-Men movies, like his regimen is like wake up at 4 a.m. Weight lift for 2 hours, eat like an entire plate of chicken, go to the gym for two hours, go shoot while you're all like bulged up and veiny.
And then a movie like X-Men Wolverine Origins comes out.
And it's like he wasted all his time on that.
But it's funny because like you look at just real quick on Hugh Jackman, go watch the original X-Men movie.
To the newest
and then
ones.
Watch Days of Future Past and just see the difference and how these movies have transformed.
Well, go back and watch like the original Bond films, like when Sean Connery was like in decent shape, but like wasn't ripped. And now to be in those movies, you need to have like an 8-pack or a 12-pack.
No, you said you got to like go and join CrossFit and be the Olympics for 4 years. I'm like, okay, now you can be in this movie.
Real quick, body horror. Have you guys seen Tetsuo, the Iron Man Japanese film?
No.
It's a body horror film too. I really love that. I've only watched it once, but it's maybe like an hour and 5 minutes or something, but it's almost like an extended music video. But you know, it's obviously not on this level, but it's more about somebody kind of, it's like more about an industrial age of like Japan. Like think of, David Lynch's, what did he do? What was one of his early films with
The Elephant Man?
No, before that,
David.
You know his first.
Eraserhead.
Yeah, it's kind of Eraserhead. You know that mentality of that industrial area they're living in. It's like that, except somebody becomes more of a machine. A man becomes a machine.
RoboCop.
It's it's like Japanese RoboCop essentially. Some guy actually, not to spoil anything, but his dick turns into a giant drill. And it like goes through a table, but it's all the soundtrack is awesome, but it's almost like one long song and it's like industrial music, like at a certain point. Yeah. Anyway, I kind of think about that film a lot when I think about The Fly too, because it's somebody transforming kind of like this body horror thing.
It is one of the things I have a hard time watching. That's why like I don't really enjoy watching the original, the good, Eli Roth movie.
Hostel?
No, not Fever. Cabin Fever. Because, like, I hate watching movies. Like, the scene that's really effective is when she's shaving her legs and her skin's falling off. Like, I hate watching stuff like that. And this movie does. Something that bothers. Like you said, the ghost stuff.
And even, like, torture porn. Like, that's just people getting tortured. Yeah. And it's like, I can't really, you know. Like, it doesn't do much for me. I don't take joy in watching somebody being tortured.
Somebody get their fingers
like,
cut off.
Are you all allergic to anything?
Because lactose intolerant.
Because like I'm allergic to certain medicines, and one time I was younger, I took a medicine, and I woke up and like, you remember that? Just hives everywhere, and it freaks you out.
Yeah.
So in if you were like transferred this to like you're doing that, and your skin's sloughing off, and you're growing little bug.
If I'm actually going to be an effect from watching a horror film, it's going to be more of a body horror than else. Jump scares can get me occasionally and stuff, and I can enjoy them. But anything that really gets under my skin is normally going to be and some then sort rips of
because that's stuff that, that hangs with you more, you know, than like, you know, because a lot of times
just whenever he's pulling his nails off,
he pulls his nail off, and then that white mucky stuff shoots all over the, it's like that's disgusting.
And
it holds up.
One of my favorite films of all time, really. And even since as a kid, like Friday the 13th, I'd like those and I would rent those. And those would be like, I'll rent those and Nightmare on Elm Street and stuff. But this was one that I like absolutely loved and would watch over and over again. Those other ones, I would just rent a different one every time and be like, okay, there wasn't any, for me when I was a kid, no Friday the 13th or Nightmare on Elm Street was really stronger than the other. Some of them had my moments that I liked better than others. But this movie just alone was so good.
You know, another thing too, it's funny, a movie this type, did they show any boobage at all in this?
Nah.
Or I'm trying to think.
The girl that he brought back, I don't think she showed her breasts, but they were mostly exposed.
Yeah. I think a girl on the street pulled them out.
Yeah.
If I'm thinking of the...
I don't think that happened in this
one. It didn't have... Okay, it had nowhere near the TNA quotient that horror films at the time did.
Yeah, that's what I was getting to. Yeah. Is like, while they had a lot of sex scenes in this movie, there wasn't a whole lot of...
They were love scenes, baby.
Yeah.
So I think that wraps up our discussion of The Fly, and now we'll move into all the final plug stuff here. So if you're enjoying the podcast, you can do us a huge favor and go to iTunes and leave a review, because that just helps more people find the podcast.
Five stars definitely helps.
Yes, we are like a high-end restaurant where it's $150 per plate. Except
we're not. We have like $1.50 a plate.
We are the dollar.
We will give you money to take the plate. Yeah.
You can leave a review there. That'll help us out. Or you can leave comments on YouTube where we get some good feedback. Or you can always send us an email at podcast@housebythevideostore.com. You can find all the work we're doing at the website, which is housebythevideostore.com. You can find links there to all of our social media accounts, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Vimeo, Vine, YouTube, everything you can find there. And we're going to have some announcements coming up soon about dates. You can see some of our short films at screenings if you're locally in the Louisville, Kentucky, or Southern Indiana area. So keep an eye peeled, and we'll have more information on that.
Or Ohio.
Or, you know, just anywhere Cincinnati. That's close. I don't know how much...
People are going to be driving from all over the country to watch some of this stuff.
Yeah, and by that you mean within the 10-mile radius. But we'll have more to announce on that coming very soon. But also, if you want to find us specifically on the internet, you can find me on Twitter @wheel_droid.
You can find me on Tumblr, Twitter, and Instagram @MetaWorldDerek.
And I'm @BlevinsSean on Twitter and @Sean2D2 on Instagram.
Yep. Oh, and if you are enjoying our work, you can also do us a big favor and go out and visit our Patreon page and make a donation of any amount, because that just helps us pay for basic stuff like site fees and server fees and trying to work on original projects. We have one short film, Hazard, which is completed and will be coming out relatively soon. And a couple of other things we are going to try to, at least one thing we're going to shoot in the next couple months. And then some other stuff.
And this coming weekend, I'm shooting
a segment
for Volumes of Blood Horror Stories. That is planned to shoot this weekend. There's been a minor/major setback. So from what I'm hearing, we're still shooting this weekend, but we're getting wrapped up into more things. So this stuff costs money. So if you like any of our stuff, William's short film Hazard comes out. It'll be online by Halloween.
Yeah.
I'm in it again,
but it'll be screening before that places. So
I think that'll bring this episode of the House by Video Store podcast to a close. Thanks for listening.